you're going to die. I said that once around a cabinet table. It was very clear that although Mr. Kretzian allowed me to be, and I say allowed me to be, the minister with special responsibility for palliative care, he wasn't sure why I wanted to do it. He did learn, however, when his very good friend and chief of staff, Jean Pelletier, died in a hospice in Quebec City. And we had a chat about that some days after the death. And he said, I now get it. I know why he wanted to be the minister with special responsibility for palliative care. And so I was in the federal cabinet, primarily to be the government leader in the Senate and to get all the bills through the Senate portion of Parliament. But I was on the agenda to speak at a cabinet meeting. And the Prime Minister gave me the nod. I could say my few words. And it was very clear that the other cabinet colleagues in the oval-shaped table were all into their own files. I mean, they had things they wanted to talk about, and they really didn't want to particularly listen to me. And so I said, you're all going to die. At which point, every head went up. And I said, now I'd like to talk to you about how you'd like to do it. As you can imagine, I became very quickly known as Madam Death. But it's amazing what we were able to accomplish in those few years, because although Mr. Kretzian said, you can use the title, but I'm not giving you any money, all the ministers knew that they had to get bills through the Senate. And so it was very easy to say to the minister responsible for corrections, you want this particular piece of legislation? What are you doing about standards of palliative care in correctional institutions in this country? Oh, well, I hadn't really thought about that, they would say. And I said, well, maybe you'd like to think about it while this bill is going through the Senate. I did that to a lot of ministers at the day. But as you all know all too well, we are very much a death-denying society. Ironic, because it's going to happen to 100% of us, but I remember particularly a speech that I gave in Portugal, and Dr. Chachanov, who was also there at that particular meeting, and they were beginning the palliative care community in Portugal at that particular point in time. And one of the comments that I made in the speech was that I wanted all undergraduate physicians trained in palliative medicine. I wanted them to know about dying. This doctor in the audience got up at the end and said, I don't know why you were so insistent that every single undergraduate physician knows about palliative care. And I said, Doctor, do you think every single physician should know how to deliver a baby? And he said, well, absolutely. And I said, well, the odds are that only 50% of the population are ever going to deliver a baby. But 100% of them are going to die. And he looked at me as if this was some revelation, you know, that he'd never considered before. I had exactly the same experience meeting with all the scientific directors of the Canadian Institutes for Health Research. And the head of the cardiology, CIHR, said to me, well, you know, your words are very interesting, but I don't know why I'm here. And I said, Doctor, none of your patients die. He said, well, of course my patients die. So that's why you're here. But that's the problem. Many of them simply don't get it. And sometimes they have to be bludgeoned into submission as we let them know. Because the reality is that while we have made tremendous progress in Canada, the best figure we have is that only 30% of Canadians are actually receiving quality palliative care in this country. And it's been 16 years that I've been working at the federal level as an advocate from within the Senate of Canada to get the attention of Canadians focused on the needs of the dying. Whether it was at the cabinet table, as I spoke about, or as minister with special responsibility for palliative care, or whether it was in front of my colleagues in the Senate, and I can assure you that they are getting very tired of hearing me speak on this topic, that I have advocated for improved palliative care services across this country, and I have, as a result, stood in rooms large and small and in front of crowds of all sizes and shared with Canadians what I hope is a vision of better care for the dying. I have visited residential hospices, palliative care units, palliative care programs in every province and in the territories, in both rural and northern settings. I've met physicians and nurses and pharmacists and researchers and social workers and physical therapists and occupational therapists and music and art therapists and volunteers and licensed practical nurses and home care workers and residential care workers, administrators, spiritual advisors, and all manner of health care workers who care for the dying and their families. And I have had the privilege of meeting patients who were at the end of their lives and their families and shared with them their experiences. And I have received countless phone calls, faxes, and emails and letters from across Canada, and I wish that I could tell you that all the stories that they tell are good ones. But unfortunately, they are not. I had a nurse walk up to me this morning to tell me that within the last couple of days, a COPD patient dying in her community isn't getting sufficient morphine because the nurse in charge was afraid that he might be addicted. Well, you know, I thought we had put that red herring to bed. That every patient is entitled to adequate pain medication. So, yes, there have been some highs and there have been some lows. But I have witnessed some incredible policy changes. The compassionate care benefit under the employment insurance plan, which doesn't give enough benefits and we thought was just opening the door and hopefully more and more would follow, unfortunately, hasn't been changed since 2004 when it was introduced. And yes, we were able to obtain millions for research, but more recently, those millions have dried up. We have established a core curriculum for all undergraduate physicians in this country, and I have seen ongoing education initiatives for nurses and for licensed nursing practitioners. I have seen the development of palliative care gold standards, even though they're not in place in every place across the country. And I have seen advanced care planning packages and improved education for physicians. And as I said so this morning, I've seen the evolution of the Canadian Virtual Hospice, which is the unsung hero in this country, as it gets 1,000 hits a day and provides comfort and support and care to many, many Canadians and others outside of this country. And it's located here in Winnipeg, in Manitoba. And we should be heralding it. We should be rejoicing in it. And yet far too many of us even don't know about it. I have seen an increase in palliative care services generally, and these are all successes. But I've also hung my head in dismay and sorrow. I remember receiving a phone call at our cottage in Victoria Beach one Saturday of Labor Day weekend some years ago. We have a woman in Ottawa who is suffering from metastatic breast cancer, and she's being treated with Tylenol 3. Is there nothing you can do for her? I said, you'll have to get the family to call me because I can't deal indirectly through a friend. The family called. That resulted in my calling the medical director of the hospital in Ottawa, telling him that he had a patient who was in intractable pain. And they said, well, they were going to refer her to the palliative care unit on Tuesday. And I said, it's Saturday. Is she going to have to be in pain Saturday, Sunday, and Monday before she's transferred to Elizabeth Bruyere? Oh, well, he would get in touch with her doctor. Well, the doctor walked into the patient's room and bawled out the patient for having had the nerve to ruin her Labor Day weekend. She was transferred to Elizabeth Bruyere on Tuesday and did have a good death. But, you know, that's simply not good enough. I have seen caregiver burnout. I had a woman who was in my office last summer. Her husband was in the final stages of ALS. She kept him at home. She was entitled to respite services. But in the previous week, she had had 14 different home care workers. So she got no respite because every time they came to give her some respite, she had to teach them how to look after her husband. I have seen crowded hospital wards with no privacy. I have seen a lack of access in some communities to the medicines in the home that these people required, or simply a hospital bed so that they could indeed keep their loved one at home. And I remember when John's father was in his late 80s and we were providing care for him in Vancouver, and he got quite testy with me one day because I kept buying equipment for him. And why didn't I rent this equipment? You know, why was I buying it? And I said, you know, Granddad, when you die, it's all going to be given away. You can afford to purchase it, and there are people out there who can't afford to purchase it. So we're going to buy it, and then you're going to give it away. And he looked at me and said, well, that's okay. And that's what we did. After he died, we hired a moving van, and we called the local home care services, and we said, who needs an electric bed? And who needs a chair with a lift? And who needs a walker? And we had all of that equipment distributed, but, you know, we shouldn't have to depend on individual families to do that kind of thing. Palliative care is unfortunately still very much a patchwork of services across this country. In a province like ours, where it is a core service, there are better coordinated services than there are in some jurisdictions. So for those of you who despair, it's actually better here. But we know it isn't equal here. We know it's better in Winnipeg than it is outside of Winnipeg. And over the past 16 years, I have been inspired by the dedication and caring of people who work in palliative care. They're really good people. They're people I want to be associated with because they express the essence of our humanity. And it really has been the work that you do every day on behalf of the dying and their families that has inspired me to give voice to the dying in this country, advocating on behalf of them for better palliative care services. Your dedication has always overwhelmed me. I remember, for example, a visit I made to a hospice in British Columbia. It was an 8-bed hospice, but there were 8 apple pies on the counter in the kitchen. I thought, well, I mean, this seems a little over the top. But one of the patients only wanted apple pies, but he really wanted mum's apple pie. So the staff had each produced an apple pie and had a contest to find out which one was closest to mum's apple pie. I vividly remember a young man who had just returned from a massage and was lying in a bed in a Toronto hospice suffering from AIDS. He told me how the hospice had been such a welcoming place for him, how well they treated him. His family having distanced themselves from him many years before when learning that he was gay. Here, he said, I am a person, not just someone dying of AIDS. Although the available services may vary from place to place within this country, universally, hospice palliative care is intensely a human and caring activity. For me, it's not synonymous with death. It's about life, about the proper care of someone who is alive, someone who has days, months, or years remaining in their life, but who is on a trajectory towards death. Palliative and end-of-life care strives to provide comfort and dignity for anyone who's in this later stage of terminal illness. And this implies that we attend to not only their medical needs, but also to their spiritual and their emotional needs. And the focus of palliative and end-of-life care is on preserving the quality of that person's life so that we minimize their suffering, but we don't minimize their experience with life. But it's not just about the patient. It's about the whole family. So for me, it's not about death. It's about living well until the very end. And it's an issue that touches each and every one of us. Everyone who we know. Our mothers, our fathers, our brothers, our sisters, our neighbors, our co-workers. And while it is an individual matter, it's also a universal issue, as almost everyone has had some experience in dealing with people who are at the final stages of their life. Mine started with the death of my own parents. My father had suffered a massive stroke, and my mother, a nurse by profession, spent the next 10 years of her life as his caregiver, to the detriment of her own health. She would never, ever have said she didn't do exactly what she wanted to do. But she died 7 months after he did. She was only 73. And it was more distressing because she died here in Winnipeg, having signed a do not resuscitate order, and the doctor in the intensive care unit decided that he had to resuscitate her anyway. My husband is certainly aware of my Irish temper, and a few of my friends are aware of my Irish temper, but I can tell you that doctor was made aware of my Irish temper as well. So like many who champion this issue, I came to it because of my experience with the death of my own parents. I have met many who have decided to become a palliative care volunteer because of their experience with the death of a loved one. Sometimes it was a good death that led them to want to help others have a similarly good death. But often it was because their loved one went through a bad death and they wanted to make it better for others. I have met a group of women who, after experiencing loss in their own lives, decided to come together to raise funds for a residential hospice in their community. They had no fundraising experience, no special knowledge, just a conviction that they could make a difference based on their own personal experience. And we look at people like Jocelyn Hutton and Dorothy Lay and Ian Anderson and Tammy Latner and Roger Nielsen. These people inspired their loved ones and families to go beyond their deaths, to find meaning, and to improve the lives of others. Filled with courage and love, 17-year-old Jocelyn Hutton was the inspiration for Western Canada's first freestanding hospice here in Winnipeg. After her death, Jocelyn's parents gave their family home to serve as a hospice, and it still serves as a hospice. Dorothy Lay was an oncologist and pioneer in palliative care in Ontario. She died in 1994 after her own battle with cancer, but her work lives on in the Dorothy Lay Hospice in Etobicoke. And just last week, I was in Toronto opening a new hospice, the Kensington Hospice, and ran into an Anglican priest who talked about the compassionate care that his mother had received earlier this summer at the Dorothy Lay Hospice. Ian Anderson's house was Ontario's first in-resident cancer hospice when it opened in 1997. Ian Anderson had died of colon cancer in 1990, and his wife Margaret, with help from her son, cared for him at home during the last months of his life. And this led Margaret and her son to establish a residential hospice in memory of her husband, so other families could be cared for and supported. In 2004, she also made a donation to fund a chair at the University of Toronto to create the Ian Anderson Continuing Education Program in end-of-life care. Tammy Lattner was diagnosed with lung cancer in 1992, and after her death, her husband Albert contributed to the Tammy Lattner Center for Palliative Care at the Mount Sinai Hospital in Toronto. The center's leading-edge home palliative care program enables people who are dying from a terminal illness to be cared for at home. Roger Nielsen, the Ottawa Senator's assistant coach, died in 2003 after a long-term battle with two forms of cancer. And Roger's house, established in 2005, is a children's palliative care hospice in the city of Ottawa. And I hope every one of you will inspire the Winnipeg Jets to, quite frankly, build a children's hospice here in Winnipeg in the same way as the Ottawa Senators have in Ottawa and the Vancouver Canucks have in Vancouver. But these are not the only instances of personal experiences leading to people reaching out to improve the care of others. Len Carpenter made a large donation to Carpenter House in Burlington, Ontario, because of his experiences in palliative care in California. And I had an aunt who died at Carpenter House in Burlington. And palliative care services and programs and hospices are not just the result of large donations by individuals. Bobby's Hope House, which opened recently in St. John, New Brunswick, is a great example of the community coming together to open a hospice, as is the North Okanagan Hospice House in Vernon, B.C. And it has been my incredible privilege to visit each and every one of these across this country, as well as almost every palliative care unit in a hospital across this country. And so the fact that we have hospices and that we have palliative care services both in the home and in hospitals across this country largely exists because of the compassion and caring of individuals who donate time and money to services in their community because of their personal experiences with death and dying. It isn't simply the large donations of homes or money that makes a difference. The gifts of handmade quilts to cover the beds in a palliative care unit, the donation of an artist's time to paint a mural on the walls of the bathing room, the remodeling of a family room, fresh flowers, a favorite biscuit recipe, a manicure, a beautiful garden outside of a window, a gift of time spent as a volunteer at the bedside. These are the things that make palliative care so very special and so very unique. It's the experience that I had of smelling a tomato soup being served in a palliative care unit, only to discover that the recipe had come from New York because one of the patients wanted tomato soup. So they had tracked down grandma's recipe in New York and were making it in a unit so that the patient who wanted grandma's tomato soup was getting it. But I've also heard too many stories and experienced it firsthand of Canadians dying in a crowded hospital ward with nothing but flimsy curtains around them to provide privacy for them and their family, or those who die in intractable pain because their physician has lacked training, or doesn't simply know what a good death is and lacks the knowledge of how or where to get the support. There are still those patients who are living with a life-threatening illness who have not been made aware of palliative services. Sadly, there are still those who think that palliative care means giving up. It's not giving up. It can go hand in hand with other treatments. But it's about care. That is its primary ingredient. It's not cure. It's about care. And our current healthcare system is all too often based on a cure model. It has meant that if we cannot any longer cure that person, we tend to shunt them aside as we make room for those who we can cure. And we have forgotten that care is just as important as cure. Canadians at end of life and their families have a right to expect that there will be the right interdisciplinary health and social service system at the right time and in the right setting based on their needs. Wherever they live in Canada, they should be entitled to equitable care and access. We should not be giving up on our dying citizens, but offering them the supports they need and deserve as fellow citizens and as valued members of our society who still have something to contribute. If we value human rights as we say we do, we must be prepared to ensure appropriate care for our citizens within an appropriate social policy framework. If we judge who we are as a nation based on how we treat our most vulnerable citizens, then we cannot help but provide better care for those who are dying. We have a moral responsibility to do so. I know that some of you in this room have heard me tell this story before, but it remains one of the most profoundly moving moments of my personal journey as an advocate for palliative care. So at risk of you hearing it again, let me repeat it. The summer of 2001 was not an easy time for me. More particularly, it was not an easy time for John. His father died in early July. And his father had said he did not want a funeral, but he was English by extraction, and so we had decided to invite all of his friends for a high tea in his home in West Vancouver. That morning, as I was preparing for that particular event, I received a call that my sister had died in Halifax. So I got hit twice in the same week. And I got through it because that week, as we were in Vancouver, I went to visit Canuck Place, the children's hospice. And as I walked in, the candle was burning, and so I knew that someone was dying. And so I asked the question, and they told me that they were bringing a young child over, basically a newborn, over from the children's hospital, because the family didn't want her to die in the neonatal unit. They wanted her to die in a more positive environment, or one that they thought was more positive. So the child was brought over to the hospice. She was still connected to her respirator. They disconnected the child from the respirator, and her family, her mother and her dad, walked the baby through the rose garden at Canuck Place, and the baby died in their arms. When they came back in, although you knew what an incredible grieving process they would have to go through, there was a sense of peace on their faces because they had allowed their baby to die in a rose garden. And so for me, that is what palliative care is about. It's allowing our loved ones, those that we care most about, to die in an environment as close as possible to a rose garden. That's why I have done this work. That's why I will continue to do this work. And that is why I appreciate the work that is done by everyone in this room. You make a difference. You are the essence of Canada's humanity. Thank you very much.